Good morning and welcome to worship. Today is the sixth Sunday after Pentecost, but we are doing something a little different. We are going to be celebrating the feast days of three women that are happening this month. So there's information in your bulletin. Mary Magdalene's feast day is on Friday, and Mary, Martha, and Lazarus' feast day is at the end of the month. If you are joining us for worship in person, you should have received your bulletin when you came in. You also should have picked up your pre-packaged communion elements. If you need either of those, feel free to get those from the back. If you are joining us online, the bulletin was emailed out. It's also available on our website, messiahoaklandnj.org, if you need it. You are welcome to join us for Holy Communion using whatever elements of bread, wine, grape juice, or crackers that you have at home. Please stand as you are able or join us in a worship position. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God whose steadfast love endures forever. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seat at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us to love our neighbors. Amen. Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free to love as God loves. Amen. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Eternal God, you draw near to us in Christ, and you make yourself our guest. Amid the cares of our lives, make us attentive to your presence, that we may treasure your word above all else, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The first reading is from the book of Genesis, the 18th chapter. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre, as he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day. He looked up and saw three men standing near him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent entrance to meet them and bowed down to the ground. He said, "My Lord, if I find favor with you, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought, and wash your feet and rest yourselves under the tree. Let me bring a little bread, that you may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant." So they said, "Do as you have said." And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah and said, "Make ready quickly 3 measures of choice flour, knead it, and make cakes." Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, "Where is your wife Sarah?" And he said, "There, in the tent." Then one said, "I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife Sarah shall have a son." The word of the Lord. Psalm 15 shall be read responsively. Lord, who may dwell in your tabernacle? Who may abide upon your holy hill? They do not slander with the tongue. They do no evil to their friends. They do not cast discredit upon a neighbor. They do not give their money in hope of gain, nor do they take bribes against the innocent.
Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 10th chapter. Now as Jesus and his disciples went on their way, he entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks, so she came to the Lord and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her." The Gospel of the Lord. How's our drawings? What did we decide on? Sounds good. Not really sure what we're drawing, but it's going to be awesome. So I have a question. Curious if you were going to take what I said earlier. That's why I asked. When do you guys have visitors?
May.
You're having a visitor today. Who's coming over?
Peyton.
Your... Woo! Play dates! All right. We love that. There was an answer over here. When do you guys have visitors? Oh, you guys are visitors to Grandpa's house? Pop-Pop's house. What about anybody else? When do you guys have visitors? Jackie? Whenever they come to the front door. Whenever they show up. Anyone else? Holidays? Do you guys have visitors at the holidays? Or are you a visitor? What else? Are there other times you might have visitors? Birthdays, yeah. I also think Miss Jackie hit the nail on the head with the whenever they show up. What do you have? Animals do show up. I had two chipmunks playing chase in my backyard this morning. I don't know. I don't know what they were doing. It's too early for me. Your cat's wrestling. Hmm. So when you have a visitor, what do? You get excited. What do we do over here? You saw a bunny and a bird and a cat. There's a lot of nature going on in our houses, right? So what do you do to prepare for a guest in the event that you know they're coming? Make food. Cook for days. Did you? Clean, get some toys ready, laundry, cleaning. I thought I heard it over here. We got some good cleaners over here. Is that right? No, Dad? No? Are they fibbing in church? So this morning, two of our readings talked about what it meant to have a guest in the Bible. Were you listening? Did you pick up on what they had to do? That's okay. Bake a cake, slaughter the best calf, and Arnie was paying attention this morning. So in the first reading, Abraham and Sarah, what did they do? They offered to provide water for their guests to wash their feet. Is that something you guys do? No? Anyone else not like feet here? So they provided the opportunity for their guests to maybe wash up or clean up. Do you have a room in your house that maybe you might invite a guest to use if they want to wash their hands or something like that? Yeah. You might invite them to use the bathroom. And Abraham and Sarah also prepared food. What's your favorite food to make when somebody comes over? Tacos? I'm going over their house. What about people who cook for days? What are your favorite things to make when people come over? That sounds delightful. Ooh, lobster tails. Okay, I'm going there too. Nice steak. What do you cook, Jeff? You make muffins with Mom? Do you let Allie help, or do you just do it all yourself? Allie gets to help? Sometimes. At least we got one honest one over here. So the last thing that Abraham and Sarah do is they allow their visitors to rest. They let them sit in the shade and they sit around and they talk. Is that something that you do when you have a visitor? You invite them to sit on the couch or out on the porch?
Not really.
Sometimes. Okay, again, good being honest. All right. So we see again in our gospel reading, we hear about Mary and Martha, and they do a very similar thing. They provide an opportunity for people to rest and to talk, and they provide lots of food. Does this sound fun to you? You want to go to these houses? Maybe? Lots of food, rest. Maybe if we're used to doing the cooking, we don't have to do the cooking. So if we do all of this for other people when they're visitors, what do you think God does for you? Yeah, God gives you time to do fun stuff with visitors. That's a great idea. Ooh, popcorn. That sounds fun. Does God also give you the food? Right? God helps the food grow that we then get to eat. Watermelons? Yeah. Same with our garden out there, right? We have all those fruits and vegetables growing, not fruits. And we will get to share them together, right? God helps all that happen. And God helps you do that work, right? And is there something else that God does for you? God gets you decorative? Oh, yeah, decorating the house, maybe for a birthday party. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And does God love you? Yeah, all the time, no matter what? You gave a speech on Christmas. Was it rattling off your presents? Well. So remember, when you're preparing for a guest, you're showing love, right? You're showing that you care about those people. And remember that when you do that, that God does that for you, that God loves you and cares for you all the time. Sound good? Beth, you are making me dizzy, my friend. We'll get up and move next week. Don't worry. I got the band coming. Peace be with you. As I said earlier, we are celebrating some feast days a little bit early right now. And a feast day is the annual celebration. Every year, Christians and Jesus followers, they celebrate a day dedicated to a saint. Now, I think it's called a feast day because it also meant they had a big feast. And there are a lot of feast days that we don't celebrate. And Council President, I'm thinking we should, because we would be having a feast like every week or multiple times a week. And I think that just sounds fun. What do you think? A lot of work. You're true. Yes. So feast days happen all the time, and I don't usually acknowledge them because I would be honest that I don't know who 90% of the saints are. But this month we are celebrating three that I do know and that I do love. So in your bulletin, you can read about Mary Magdalene. Her feast day is on Friday the 22nd. And we're not going to talk about her today because she gets a whole lot of airtime at Easter as that first disciple to say Jesus is alive. But at the end of the month, we have the feast day of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. And we will be honoring and celebrating today, because the gospel reading timed out, Martha's action and Mary's contemplation. Our hymn of the day today is one of my favorites. And when you're using the ELW, if you're here in person, you will see there's about 12 verses, with each verse dedicated to a different woman. We are not singing all of them, even though I would love to. But the verse 7, is dedicated to Martha and Mary. And the verse concludes with the words, "Keep our hearts attentive to the truth you declare, and strengthen us for service when work becomes our prayer." In celebrating these women, as we have done before, we're going to play with the text a little bit and see what we can learn about specifically Martha more than Mary, in 4 verses. So there are a lot of Marys in the Bible. In fact, I saw a skit once with Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of Jesus, Mary and Martha, and one of them just said, "Let's just eat, drink, and be merry." However, there's not a ton of pairings of Mary and Martha in the Bible. In fact, there's only one that we know of, and we can see both in the Gospel of Luke and the Gospel of John 2 times that Jesus interacts with this family. Now, verse 39 tells us that Mary and Martha are sisters, that she had a sister named Mary. The Gospel of John tells us that they also have a brother named Lazarus, but he's not mentioned today. We're not sure why. The other thing that this text can tell us in verse 40 is that I believe that Mary and Martha specifically, had a really strong faith. Because in verse 40, Martha goes up to Jesus and says, "Don't you care?" She goes to Jesus and asks him a very bold question. I see that as someone with very strong faith and understanding that they can, in fact, ask Jesus that type of question. And the other thing that I think is really fascinating that we can learn in this text is that verse 38 reads, "A woman named Martha welcomed him into her home." This verse can tell us that she is the homeowner. If the house belonged to Lazarus, it would have said Lazarus's house. If Martha had a husband, it would have said, whatever her husband's name is, house. We see it all over in Scripture. It's always on the man's side. The man owns the property. But right here, this is Martha's house, which is really pretty cool. The other thing that I find interesting about this house is that theologians and scholars believe that this house was a house church. The early Jesus followers gathered in people's homes around meals, which is not unlike how our church started in a community hall. And the fact that people were gathered and worshiping, they would teach and learn from each other, and according to Palestinian culture, women would likely have served food, because serving food was a way to honor guests in your house. Now, the reason that I think that this is true, that this may have been a house church, a worshiping community, is because this is the first time we see Jesus interacting with Mary and Martha's household. And so I picture that, how would Jesus have found them? He might have walked into town and said, "Where is a place that we can gather for worship?" And people there would have said, "Hey, go to Martha's house. She's already got people there." So we're going to use this idea called sacred imagination, and it's a way to play with the text, to bring it to life, and to imagine yourself in the text, or maybe what it would have been like. And so if Martha's house was a house church, the way that I see this all happening is that maybe every day, or once a week, the way that our tradition has changed, people gathered at Martha's house. They would sit around and talk, probably outside. They would share stories about Jesus and things that they learned or things that they heard. They would spend time in fellowship and community. And more than likely, there were women who were preparing a meal that they would then share together. So, with our gospel reading in this idea, I can see it being a common practice that somebody new arrived at the house and Martha came out to greet them, invited them to join in the conversation, and then went back to work. What's different about this gospel text is that it was Jesus who showed up. So Jesus shows up to the house. Mary and Martha go out. They welcome Jesus into their home as they have every other person. And Mary says, you know, this is the dude. Like, this is the guy. I want to stay and learn. And Martha says, well, I need to go back, and I need to go back to my work of serving the meal so that we can all eat together. Naturally, as anyone who has ever hosted guests and been left to do all the work, sorry, Mother, you get frustrated. You get annoyed. And so Martha turns to that faith. She turns to Jesus and she says, Lord, do you not care? I'm left to do all this work alone. I'm trying to serve you all a meal. Again, I see this questioning as strength in her faith, knowing that she can argue with Jesus and Jesus is going to love her anyway. And also in this moment, what I see Martha doing is engaging this practice of questioning and engaging faith as opposed to just learning about it. Mary is silent. She's just sitting there learning. And oh boy, would I love to do that at the feet of Jesus. But Martha in this moment takes it a step further to say, I'm going to question your teaching. Should she be here or should she be helping me? Now, this text is traditionally interpreted in the way that Jesus responds to Martha. And many over the years have said that Jesus is chastising Martha, that she was distracted, and she should be leaving Mary alone. Interpreting the text in this light puts one sister against the other. And as someone with a sister, I don't really love listening and hearing that. I think instead we can interpret this in a more life-giving way. That Jesus is not chastising Martha, but Jesus is teaching her the importance of dwelling in the Word of God. That hearing and learning from Jesus, who's in your house right now, should be more important right now than doing the service that you need to do. Jesus is saying, if you learn and you grow and you understand your faith, come and sit with me. And then, once you feel good about that, then maybe you'll want to continue running your house church and doing that ministry of feeding people. Jesus is saying, take time to spend time in the Word of God, and let that inspire what you do. Don't let distraction and worry and tasks, your to-do list, take your focus off of God's presence. Not every day that Jesus shows up in the flesh. And so Jesus is saying, come and sit with me before you go back to your duties. Mary did nothing wrong. Mary just realized that I was here and spent time to sit and learn with me. Didn't mean that Mary wasn't going to go help later. See, Jesus is saying that one ministry, the ministry of word and the ministry of service, one is not greater than the other. In fact, they inspire each other. See, many people are comfortable doing the work. It's a tangible thing. We can see the difference it makes to do a collection and to hand it out, to distribute food, to make sandwiches, to clean up a yard. We can see the difference and we know we've done something good. But most people, myself included, are uncomfortable with the idea of being. Sitting in silence, taking time to pray, reading and wrestling with scripture, not just listening to it, but engaging it, makes us vulnerable, makes me a little nervous sometimes, can often bring up difficult questions that I have to then wrestle with. I don't like to focus inward, I like to focus outward. And I think some other people might agree. But the gospel this morning shows the importance of needing to do both. Our faith is not either or, it is both and. Jesus invites the women to join him, to learn from him, and then to go back and help. See, doing can be and often is exhausting. We are always doing, always striving to do more. We can get caught up in the never-ending need. There's always another mouth to feed. Jesus says it himself, you will always have the poor with you. We can also become jaded by systems that don't change or make things better. Why are there still so many hungry people? Why is the cost of food still going up? And we can lose sight of why we do what we do. It's often called compassion burnout. Getting so stuck in the need that you forget the greater picture. You forget why you do this. I wonder if that was happening to Martha. She was so stuck in needing to prepare the perfect meal that she forgot why she was doing it. Because Jesus was there. I wonder how many times that may have happened also to you. And so, like Mary, it is important to take time to recenter ourselves in the Word and on God. We do that in worship every week or every day or however your worship practices are. We take that time to center and reconnect with God. Our worship begins with the confession and forgiveness, where we confess our sin and hear that assurance of forgiveness. As I heard someone say it once, when they heard that forgiveness, they said, "That's it? That's it." God's forgiveness is always there. And so when we confess our sins, it can help us to recenter on God, to admit our shortcomings and be reminded that God forgets all of that and asks us to keep going. We read scripture, we dwell in it, we ask questions, we talk about it, more so in things like Bible study than in worship, but I do my best, I try. And when we do that, when we're engaging with scripture, it allows us to center on God, knowing that the early Jesus followers didn't always get it right either. Martha wasn't perfect. Mary wasn't perfect. None of the disciples were perfect. But God is always at work, and that is what Scripture reminds us. And we join together in communion, partaking in the holy meal together, centering on God's love and forgiveness given for you. Every week, every time you engage in the meal. And lastly, we sing, we dance, we pray, we lift our voices to God because we believe in hope for a better world. And like Mary, taking this time to center on God's word, on God's action in the world, gives us the strength to go out and do it. So to the Marthas out there, always working, let the word inspire your service. Let God's word inspire your daily actions, your care of your neighbor, and remind you to turn back and to center on God. And if you're a little more like Mary, maybe focus inward on faith. Remember that it is just important to take some time to show your faith in the world, whether it's through a conversation or through service, because our faith needs both. God invites us to do both, to do like Mary, to do like Martha, and to be like Mary. Amen.
Thank you.
profess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
God, who sees and knows all things, who hears our prayers and listens to our cries, we lift these prayers to you out loud and silently in our hearts. God of mercy, we thank you for the resurrection dawn, bringing the glory of our risen Lord, who makes every day new. We thank you especially for the sustaining goodness of your creation, for the gifts of healing and forgiveness, for the gifts of relationships with others, for the communion of faith in your church. For what else do we thank God?
For those celebrating birthdays, especially Helen and Nancy.
God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of might, renew this weary world. Heal the hurts of all your children, and bring about your peace for all in Christ Jesus, the living Lord. We pray especially for those who govern nations of the world, for the people in countries ravaged by strife or warfare, for all who work for peace and international harmony, for all who strive to save the earth from carelessness and destruction, for the believers of Christ in every land, for those in need of healing and comfort. For what and who else do we pray?
Peggy. Eleanor.
The family of Bill Malloy.
Siblings that are often put against each other.
For healing from COVID for Nancy. For good surgery for Eleanor.
Carol and Greg.
God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of grace, we cry out to you and pray for all those in need, knowing that prayer changes lives. For what else do we want to pray to God?
For all those traveling, may their travels be safe and their health be good.
God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. You may share a sign of peace with those around you. reminder offering can be left in the plate, mailed to the church, or given online. Let us pray our offering prayer together. God of abundance, you have set before us a plentiful harvest. As we feast on your goodness, strengthen us to labor in your field and equip us to bear fruit for the good of all. In the name of Jesus, amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Praise to you, glorious God of grace. Throughout the ages, you have blessed us with the foremothers of the faith. With Sarah, we bless you for your gift of life. With Ruth, we praise you for your family and food. With Miriam, we celebrate our escape from the foe. Remembering Deborah, we honor the words of your prophets. Remembering the woman at the well, we laud you for living water. Remembering Junia, we thank you for those who minister among your people. One with the daughter of Jairus, we wake to life in you. With Mary, we magnify your name. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. Remembering Martha and Mary, we join Jesus at this meal. Living, he healed the bleeding woman. Dying, he cared for his mother. Risen, he sent Mary Magdalene in mission. On the night before he died, he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Mighty God of mercy, as you heard the prayers of Hannah, now hear us. Send your spirit on this bread and wine, but sharing the body and blood of Christ, we become his body in the world. Send your spirit on this assembly that, like Phoebe, we serve one another with zeal. Send your spirit on the church that, like Anna, we tell others of your mercy. Send your spirit into our hearts that, like Dorcas, we care for the poor and needy. All praise to you, powerful God of peace. We adore you. Our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you who mother and feed and comfort us, today, tomorrow, and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the power of the Holy Spirit, using whatever language or translation is most familiar to you, we pray as Jesus taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses. We forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." The gifts of God for the people of God. The body and blood of Christ given for you. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Let us pray. Life-giving God, through this meal, you have bandaged our wounds and fed us with your mercy. Now send us forth to live for others, both friend and stranger, that all may come to know your love. This we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Receive this blessing. The God of peace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you, comfort you, and show you the path of life this day and always. Amen. For the announcements. I promise they will be quick. Just a few notes. Thursday Bible study is happening this week, so feel free to join us around noontime out here in the narthex. There's information about Synod Day in the bulletin. There's also a request to find out who else was going. So So there is a sign-up sheet in the narthex if you want to put your name on, if you want to go to Synod Day at Six Flags Great Adventure. You will need to register on your own, though. Also, book club. Jackie is hoping that the last week of the month we will be having our gathering. So if you got the email, please make sure you respond with your availability. If you did not get the email and you want to join in, please let us know and talk to Jackie after church. Lastly, I'm going to turn it over to Bob real quick for a worship announcement.
Just a note about our hymn motto, which we all love very much. Since next week is contemporary worship and the band is playing, we wanted to give everybody a little more time to prepare the music. So instead of doing hymn motto today, what Pastor and I did was we selected all the songs from the favorites that have been submitted for hymn motto. So they're all favorites, they're all in hymn motto, so it's kind of like a giant hymn motto that we just kind of did ahead of time. Thank you.
Thanks. The band's been practicing. It should be really good worship, so we hope you join us either in person or online. Are there any other announcements for the good of the order? No. Go in peace. Love your neighbor.